Thank you, Desmond, and good evening, everybody. So this evening I want to share with you some thoughts in relation to what I think marketing can do for Waterford, city and county, but also, in fact, any business. This is not a presentation that's unique to tourism. And if there's one thing that I would like you to remember from this evening's talk, it's the importance of long-term planning. That above everything else, if that's the only thing that you take from this evening, that would be a success for me. So to begin with, I've broken the presentation down into three areas, which for me represent the three secret ingredients of a very successful marketing strategy. The first is to be distinctive, not necessarily differentiated, and they're not the same thing. Distinctiveness and differentiation are related, but they're quite different. Take the long view. Unfortunately, in our world, in our industry, there's far too much short-term thinking. It infects business in a very damaging way. And the third is to prioritize creativity, not to treat creativity as a commodity, but something to be nurtured and invested in. So those are the three pillars of the presentation this evening, and I'll bring you through each of those now. The first is don't try to be different, be distinctive. Some of the great brands in the world, take Coca-Cola, never talks about how good its product tastes. It never compares its product to its competitors, like Pepsi. It instead is very distinctive in its marketing around a number of assets and styles of communication. Pepsi, on the other hand, which is a far smaller business than Coca-Cola, tried for many years to persuade us that it tasted better with the Pepsi Taste Challenge. They were going for a differentiation strategy, whereas Coca-Cola went for a distinctive strategy. And that's true of many, many brands. Only about 10% of people who consume brands actually think that they are very different to other brands. Only 10%, and it's more or less on average across all categories. So that means that 90% of people who are buying brands are not buying them because they think they're different. They're buying them for other reasons. So differentiation is a weak strategy. Unless there is an outstanding functional difference, consumers do not see the brand they buy as differentiated. Now there are exceptions. Hence, unless there is an outstanding functional difference. So Ryanair, for example, has an outstanding functional difference, and therefore it has been able to market on a long-term basis on being a low-fares airline, because its entire business is structured around that, and competitors find it very difficult to copy them. But that's the exception. Distinctive assets increase brand visibility. And what we should aim to do in marketing is choose unique identifying characteristics over unique selling propositions. A lot of marketing textbooks will tell you that before you begin to market your product, you need to have a USP, a unique selling proposition, something that makes you different. In reality, what you should be looking for is a unique, distinctive asset for your brand. Assets like Nike Swoosh, like the Tato Man, like the McDonald's Golden Arches, or perhaps the Viking. We'll come back to that. That's the first section. The second section of the presentation is about taking the long view. And short-term thinking is on the increase. It's on the increase in industry in general. It's certainly on the increase in marketing. This particular graph looks at the rise in short-term advertising campaigns over the last number of years. And you can see with the onset here of the global financial crisis in 2007, the percentage of advertising campaigns that were short-term in nature started to grow exponentially. Because I think in times of challenge, we start to think about hand-to-mouth. We need to get them in the door now. None of that brand-building rubbish. Let's pile them high, sell them cheap, and have promotional messages. And that's what has happened as a result. However, short-term thinking damages businesses. And unfortunately, we're geared as human beings to think short-term. even the way that PLCs are required to report on a quarterly basis, no longer in Europe, by the way, but in America, they're still required to report quarterly, feeds that short-termism. And therefore, I suppose, incentivizes that kind of thinking over long-term planning. So it's damaging businesses, and it's not a recent phenomenon. Peter Drucker, one of the gods of business consultancy, said famously a number of years ago, short-termism is damaging, if not destroying, the wealth-producing capacity of businesses. Long-term results cannot be achieved by piling short-term results on short-term results. And it is true today as it was then. The human condition hasn't changed. The global financial crisis is largely over, but unfortunately, those habits have remained intact. Long-term campaigns, on the other hand, build more profit. Research, extensive research into this, has shown that long-term marketing campaigns are 3 times more efficient than short-term campaigns in growing market share. 3 times more efficient. And I'm going to show you a little bit of science to back that up. There's only 1 or 2 charts in the presentation, so don't worry. This particular graph is looking at, in the dark green, it's looking at the impact of short-term campaigns. The light green is looking at the impact of long-term campaigns. And as you can see on this segment of the chart, short-term campaigns are more effective than long-term campaigns in the short term. And that's the problem. Because when people go out into the market with a big sales message, heavily discounted messaging, it works for a short period of time. It takes long-term initiatives longer to gain traction. However, when you look at the longer-term measures, such as market share effects and profit effects, long-term campaigns always outstrip the impact of short-term thinking. But both are important. There is a magic formula. Short-term and long-term are both important, and this is the magic formula, 60-40. Sounds very neat, but it's been proven over 20 years of data, over hundreds and hundreds of case histories, that brands that employ this type of budget allocation will optimize the return on their investment. So 40% of your marketing effort should be based on short-term sales activation, promotional-based messaging, and 60% should be based on long-term brand-building initiatives. The kind of activity that will make next year's sales easier to achieve, rather than always picking the low-hanging fruit that's in the market today. That's the second pillar of the presentation. I deliberately made the presentation short because I know I'm the only thing standing between you and Ireland versus Denmark, so I hope you'll thank me for that. The third is to prioritize creativity. Creativity trumps everything. It is in the sphere of influence that we have in marketing, it is the lever that we are, I suppose, most in control of and will have the most impact on things that we do. The way we measure creatively rich campaigns is to analyze those campaigns that were award-winning and compare them with campaigns that weren't. And again, this analysis is very compelling. Creatively awarded campaigns are 6 times more efficient than non-awarded campaigns in terms of their ability to grow market share. So we must invest in creativity. Never think of it as a commodity. And it's not just about the execution, it's about the thought that goes into the development of it and the craft of its execution. Within creativity, emotional campaigns drive more profit. Emotional campaigns endure longer in the memory of consumers, and there is a lot of science to prove that all decision making is in the emotions. All of our decision making tends to be from an emotional place, even if you think it comes from a rational place. So that's why emotional messaging in advertising is so very, very powerful. Emotional campaigns outperform rationally based campaigns on every business measure. And this is a crucial point in tourism marketing, appealing to the emotions of the visitor and not some other rational reason to come. I'm going to show you three case histories now. One is from the retail business and two from the tourism business that hopefully will bring some of these points to life. John Lewis, a very famous marketing organization, they don't have outlets in Ireland, but they are a very famous British department store retailer. Up until about 7 years ago, they employed classic retail type advertising, price related, very short term, very, very rational. And their business had plateaued. They were in the doldrums in relation to profit, and there was no growth whatsoever. This was a 100-year-old business in a very mature category, department stores. They had 23% market share, not bad, but there was no growth. They decided to do a complete review of their marketing strategy, and they were persuaded to put all of that rational campaign to the side and to think of a more emotional place to be where they could connect with the consumer. This is the fifth or sixth in the series of John Lewis commercials. Every Christmas, as you probably know, they unveil the latest one. The most recent one was unveiled last Friday. It's called Moz the Monster. I'm not going to show you that this evening. This one is about Man on the Moon. I hope you enjoy it. It gets me every time. Wonderful, isn't it? It's such a beautiful piece of communication, and a lot of cynics would say, that's not going to make me going to go and shop in John Lewis. There's nothing, it's not telling me anything, there's no proposition. There's nothing that's saying, come here and you'll get stuff better or cheaper than anywhere else. And a lot of cynics would say, that kind of advertising has no impact on me, it doesn't work, it's a waste of money. Well, it's not. And this is the result of that campaign. So in 2000, you can see this is the market share of John Lewis, 2008, 2009, 2010, 2011, the campaign is launched, and it went from 23% market share to 30% market share in 6 years. Incredible, in a mature category like department stores, unheard of. And that was entirely down to that marketing investment. Nothing about prices or line listing products. Now, they did that as well, but they did that in the proportion 60 to 40. They spent 60% of their marketing budget on that campaign and 40% on traditional retail-orientated advertising. But better than that, they also invested in what we call econometric modeling. Econometric modeling is a very sophisticated form of proving the impact that marketing has on revenue. And they did that every year, so they could find out exactly what impact the advertising was having on their business. So they were able to isolate it in all of the other variables that can impact their business. And they found that the investment generated 1.75 billion in extra sales revenue, but once you take all the costs out of that, half a billion nearly in additional profit over 5 years from that kind of advertising approach. So it's a stunning case history that really shows the power of an emotional communication. And even though the creative every year is different, it all follows the same structure, the same central message, the same type of approach to the soundtrack, so it's true to the campaign idea. So that's nothing to do with tourism. Now let's have a look at a couple of tourism examples. Game of Thrones, Northern Ireland. Northern Ireland is lucky enough to be one of the locations for the Game of Thrones. And this is called the Dark Hedges, which is, as you know, a very famous landmark in Northern Ireland that's used in the Game of Thrones. And they use this, I spoke earlier on about being distinctive. This is a tremendous example of being distinctive and a fantastic example of end-to-end thinking. Somebody came up with a brilliant idea, which you're about to see. It's been a major award-winning case study. But the beautiful idea wasn't just done on its own. It followed a wonderful line of thinking that really brought it back into affecting tourism. So I'll let the case study now speak for itself. So very clever, and that's a great example of being distinctive. You know, Northern Ireland, apart from having the landscapes that are used in Game of Thrones, doesn't have any other real connection to that film or that series, but they're using it to be highly distinctive and highly effective as a result. They didn't do econometric modeling, however, they did see an 8% increase in visitors year on year. I'm sure there were other things that contributed to that, so you can't just put it down to that initiative. What they did earn, I think they spent £130,000 or euro in promoting that, but because it was such an inventive idea, it caught fire socially and earned about 17 million in free exposure as a result of that. That's something you can't plan for, by the way, it's a bonus. Some people say to people in our industry, can you create a viral piece of marketing for us? Nobody can do that. It's 1 in 100 that actually manage to do that. You can't, if that's your strategy, you don't have a strategy. But when it works, it's a great bonus. The next one, the last one, is similar, and it's New Zealand. And New Zealand is the location for the Lord of the Rings and also the Hobbit. And one of the things common to that is Middle Earth. So the New Zealand Tourism Board decided to use that as their distinctive asset. And this is their story.
One place is synonymous with Middle Earth, and that is New Zealand. New Zealand is Middle Earth on Earth, where Gandalf strides, hobbits walk, and Gollum creeps. So this year we aim to earn as much media as we could by using our association with all things Middle Earth. Bearing in mind, of course, we're here to sell the country, not the film. Warner Brothers would prepare to represent the film themselves. And we have to be very careful not to tread on their seed toes. So, 100% Middle Earth is 100% pure New Zealand with Warner. Copyright 2012 Warner Brothers Entertainment, trademarks, all sense. So, we launched a 2-minute online film without telling anyone we paid English actor Ian Hunt to do the voiceover. Fans worked it out themselves. It's still there. Sir Peter seeded our film with his 600,000 fans and was even kind enough to let us shoot our closing scene at Bag End. We found one of the world's only Elvish coaches, and for a week trained spokesman in the language. Then, come the day of the Hobbit's premiere, without any notice, we broadcast the nation with the forecast, entirely in Elvish. Online, we created exclusive content by enlisting some of Sir Peter Jackson's magicians to create amazing renditions of Middle Earth for us. These were based on the stunning landscapes in our own campaign. Some of these artworks were so good, Warner Brothers got jealous and banned them, and then after the premiere, unbanned them. Then senior contributor to the OneRing.net, Larry Curtis, was invited here for the premiere and was almost the first to receive an actual Welcome to Middle Earth passport stamp in his American passport. And he was the first to tweet, book face, and Instagram those images to his thousands of fans. And that's the end of our story.
So the thing about being distinctive and using distinctive assets, it's far easier to refresh existing memory structures in people's minds than it is to build new ones. And very often marketers keep chopping and changing because they're tired of the campaign. And that's a disaster because people aren't that interested. And what you need to do is you need to create an opportunity for your brand to be remembered when they're considering where to go for that short break. That's the job, to get it into that consideration set. And you can achieve that by being true to a central idea and be consistent around that over a long period of time and not chop and change because you're fed up with it. Because every time you chop and change, what happens is you have to start again in building those memory structures with the consumer. It's the reason why so many marketers have made a disaster of changing the packaging of their product. For no other reason except because they felt it was the right thing to do. And immediately you're making your product harder to find for the consumer who's used to seeing a certain type of thing. We often get in the way of ourselves. Like marketing is not complicated, but sometimes the professionals complicate it for themselves. 16% increase year on year in global traffic to newzealand.com as a result of that campaign. So what's this got to do with Waterford? Well, I didn't know anything about the Viking connection with Waterford, and I know we're going to do some research to see what the nationwide awareness of the Viking connection with Waterford is, but I'd say it's not as high as you think it is. And I think there's a real opportunity for the Viking connection to be your distinctive asset because it's very powerful. I did some Googling in preparation for this presentation. And the Irish Times, when it comes to touching popular imagination and packing in visitors, the Vikings certainly have it. One of the challenges that has been raised with me in the past is, well, we've got so much more to offer than just the Vikings. Why would we put all of our eggs into that one basket? Because that is your opportunity to be distinctive. Waterford has what every city has. You know, it's a lot of the things that you think you have that make you great are just hygiene factors. Every city has them. So why talk about those individual elements on their own when you can talk about something that captures the imagination of people? Game of Thrones ignites new collector interest in Viking jewelry. Vogue, for heaven's sake, is eating like a Viking the next it diet. And when I thought, I wonder what Vikings ate, I'd say it's disgusting. It's actually not. It's really nice food that you could make a festival around. Also, you've got this, you know, global phenomenon, which is the Vikings television series. So Vikings are definitely in, and Waterford has a really rich story to tell. But it's not just about the Vikings, and I'll come on to that in a minute. But if you think about all of the assets, you have Reginald's Tower, the longboat, even Waterford Crystal has got in on the act with its longboat. You've got Des Whelan's Viking Marathon, well done Des. You've got, you know, the King of Vikings and the virtual reality experience that is. Also, the Waterford Treasures Museums have realized the power of marketing around the Vikings. So the Viking for me is a very interesting place to start. And you can build a really strong, powerful narrative around that. But then you bind to that all of the other tremendous assets that make Waterford a really compelling destination. The North Quay development, hopefully in the future, will be very much part of that story. The Waterford Treasures, Viking Triangle, Waterford Crystal, Food and Festivals, Ireland's Ancient East, Copper Coast, and the Waterford Greenway are all really rich elements of what the proposition is that can all be bound to that particular asset and tell the story through it, which will make it very compelling and very memorable for visitors. So in terms of the various stages involved in building this, the first stage is the discovery stage, where you carry out research in relation to what do people think of Waterford today? Where does it stand in the ranking of places they think of when they're thinking of a short break in Ireland? And at the get-go, it's absolutely essential that there is an independent marketing consultant appointed to handle this. I kind of get the sense, as there is in lots of organizations like this, that politics will be at play. Various stakeholders wanting their piece of the pie. If this kind of initiative is planned from within, sometimes it can fail. I would suggest strongly you need to have an independent, strong voice on the outside who can really bring the kind of thinking to this problem that is required. The second stage is to build. So what is it that we can do together? Assemble the team, discover what all the assets are, and try and pull them together in a very cohesive way. And then the third part of the plan is to build out the experience and bring the campaign to the public. In terms of investing, it's important to scale the investment over time. Start off in year one with a small investment, where you can have a few quick wins around all the marketing collateral that is around Waterford City and County coming from the same place, instead of the quite disjointed impression I have of looking at the various marketing collateral I see for Waterford City and County. And then year two and year three, and as the North Quay development comes on stream, more budget will be available to then really ramp it up. But the most important thing is to have an organizing idea that you consistently promote in the coming years. And that's it. Thank you very much.